Welcome to our final night of the Unity Revival. It's been a great week, and we're going to continue tonight and go out with a bang. It's going to be a great, great night. Thank you all so much for being here. Every night has been a blessing, a challenge, and it's going to be even so tonight. So we're going to have a great night here at the fifth night of revival. So with that being said, I'm going to pray. After I pray, Teresa Armstrong is going to come and sing for us. After that, Ken Wilkes is going to come and give his testimony tonight. We've been doing testimonies, and he's going to share his with us. And then it's Tegan's night. She's going to come and introduce our speaker. Some of y'all have seen this guy before. He will look familiar to you. So we'll enjoy that. And then when he comes, he'll lead us in a time of worship, and then he'll speak. It's going to be a special night. We're looking forward to it. But before we get into that, let's go to the Lord in prayer and pray that he would just allow us to have a time of worship here tonight, okay? Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that you've allowed us to assemble. And Lord, as we come here for this last night of revival, what we want to do tonight and our goal this whole time has been, as a faith family, as brothers and sisters in Christ, to come together to unite. If we will be united as a faith family, Lord, there's nothing that's too big or too little. What we want to do is be united for this neighborhood, for this country, for all the world. Lord, Harbor Lake can make a great impact, not because we are great, but because we serve an even greater God, the God of all time and space, the God that said, "Let there be light," and there was light, the God that moved over the waters, the God that came in the form of man and died in our place. Thank you, Lord, for all your many blessings. Hold on to us. Keep us in your hand, for there's nowhere else we would want to be. Now, this is your time. We pray that we would honor you in everything that we do tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Teresa. Thank you.
solo. Solo, none of you are going to hear me. Well, most of you heard my testimony over the years, but it's still part of me. So I was raised in the church. Early as I can remember, went to the church, and I was baptized when I was 11. And I got baptized because what you're supposed to do is get baptized. I don't remember talking too much about Jesus and all back in those days. Maybe they did, and I just didn't hear. I don't know. But went on through high school, joined the Navy, and when I joined the Navy, I decided I was going to meet or exceed all the myths and legends you heard about sailors, and I worked at it really hard, and continued on for a long time during the during my time in the Navy, and always looking for something else. It was never satisfied. Always looking, and ended up got married, and to Jeannie. It's gonna be 38 years in June, and I ended up in Norfolk. The Navy base here closed. The submarine I was on decommissioned, and I got stationed in Norfolk. And I was just running, And one night, I still remember. I can't tell you what day of the week or what the date was. I can remember that night pretty clearly though. And I was flipping through the channels in my barracks room, and I can still see that room. And there's a Billy Graham crusade was on, and I could not change the channel. And that night, I heard the Lord speak finally. And Ira said Monday that she had prayed the sinner's prayer so many times. I had prayed that prayer so many times. I thought, wake up in the morning, something's going to be different, and nothing's ever different. It just, I just never felt anything different. But that night, Billy Graham, said something that pricked my ears there about, you need to make a commitment. And I had never made a commitment, not once. And that night, I gave my heart to the Lord, and I said, I will follow. And that night, he took away my desire to drink. And it took him a while, took about 6 months to clean my nasty mouth up, and a little bit longer there to calm my temper down. It still comes back up a little bit there, but we're working on it. But I quit looking. I didn't need to look anymore. I was satisfied. I was content. And that contentment is only found in Jesus Christ. He filled the hole that I was missing. He gave me the peace that goes beyond all understanding. And that's where I'm at today. Thank you.
Tony was called to missionary in 2004, and he previously served as a youth pastor, worship pastor, and now serves as lead pastor at Calvary Baptist Church in Monk Corner. After 14 years of faithful service to Harbour Lake, please welcome back Tony Stevens.
I can shake his hand when he comes up.
Hi, I'm Tony. How are y'all? Let's go around the room. What's your name? No, I'm kidding. It's great to see everybody. Let's do this. Let's worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords first and foremost tonight, because that's what we're here to do. Amen. And then we'll take the opportunity to open God's Word. I'm going to let everybody in on some of the things that have been going on in my life, and then I hope and I pray that your heart is open to receive this opportunity that we have in the future for new unity within our churches. Amen? So let's stand together and let's worship a little bit. And whatever order you want to do them in, brother, I'm good. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone and I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God and I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. And I've been born again to your family. Oh, your love flows through my veins. And I'm no longer child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child. No longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child of Travis, will you do this for me? Let's do Holy Forever. We'll wrap up our worship time with this.
The highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, oh, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, if you've been redeemed, we'll sing the song. Holy, you alone.
Father God, we praise you tonight, Lord. We just want to lift your name high. Lord, as we come together tonight, Lord, pray that your name would be praised and raised above everything. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your word that you've given us. Lord, what a blessing it is to stand in this place, Lord, tonight, and to bring your word to this family, this place that I called home for so many years. Thank you for the salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that moves in us and touches us, that convicts us and calls us. And Father, most importantly, Lord, we just thank you for the community that we have together as people who are saved by the blood of the Lamb and are called according to your purpose. We praise you in Jesus' name tonight. Amen. Amen. Y'all can, yeah. Sorry.
I have certain liberties that I'm used to every Sunday morning at Calvary, and so it's hard to go somewhere else and not just jump into the way that I'm used to doing things. So y'all forgive me for just a moment. All right, so I know everybody's been asking, and so I'm going to take just a couple of minutes here to share with you a little bit about the family and what's going on. Tori sends her regards tonight, says she loves everyone, she wishes she could be here, but she is working tonight. She is 7 months away, 8 months away, sorry, from finishing her nursing degree. She went back to school to be a nurse, yep. And she is almost finished. Please pray for her. She has one of her hardest finals that she'll take throughout the course of the program on Monday. So please pray for her. And she is working tonight. She works at Roper Hospital downtown. And she has rearranged her schedule already about three times to make it to where she doesn't have to work during her finals. And also, she's going out of town with some of the ladies from our church beginning next Thursday. They're going to Tennessee for a few days. And so when I told her that I was preaching here and I'd really love for her to come, she said, there is no way I can go back and ask a fourth time for them to rearrange my schedule. I said, I believe they're going to understand. It's no problem. Now, Anna Grace and Jacob would have been here. However, they are in the bustling metropolis of St. George tonight, where Anna Grace and her varsity softball team, she plays for St. John's Christian Academy, they are working very hard to make it into the playoffs this year. And so they had a region game tonight, and so she was unable to be here. And then, of course, since I wasn't here, Jacob went with her to make sure that she got home okay. And I think he just enjoys going out there and hanging out with the softball team as well. And then there's the other one. The prodigal. No, I'm just kidding. Jared is, as y'all know, he is, I want to share this with you, and there's already been three or four times I've already choked up tonight. The last one was when I heard Tina sing in harmony with me over here. I was like, oh man, do I miss that? But this one legitimately, I don't know if I'm going to get through. Jared could not be here this weekend because he is... Are we on the internet? I can't tell that story. I'll tell y'all when we get through. But yeah. And I just hope she can't read lips. They don't watch me anyway. Why would I care? It's like I'm the old guy now, you know? They don't watch me anymore. So that's what's going on with the family. They wish they could be here. I'm hoping I can bring 4/5 of them with me tomorrow as we send off Teresa Kicker down the highway a little bit. But hey, I'm excited. I'm thankful to be back here, and I want to share something with you very quickly before we open up the Word tonight. Y'all have known me my entire ministry life, just about my entire ministry life. The 13 years I spent here, there were 4 years we spent at. I was in a little bit of ministry at Olive Baptist Church back in Pensacola, Florida. Where Tori and I served, where we started our family. Y'all have known me as a music guy and the youth guy. I got dragged into the youth thing kicking and screaming and then found out that I loved it. And so I stuck with it for a very long time. Back in 2019, when God was opening the door for me to go to Calvary in Monk's Corner, I was in the meeting with the search committee. Pastor John Jenkins was there, and he looked at me and he said, as we're going through this whole thing, he says, Tony, he says, do you ever see yourself being a senior pastor? And y'all, right there in the middle of the interview with the entire search committee, I laughed out loud. I said, there's no way I'd ever be a senior pastor. And they said, why? I said, it's all them people down the road at 1056. No, I'm just kidding. It wasn't y'all. I never saw myself as being a senior pastor. And it's because I had such a love for the things that I was doing. I had such a love for my youth. I had such a love for sharing God's word through music and the expressiveness that that brings. And I thought there's no way I would ever take the job as a senior pastor. Don't ever tell God you're not going to do something. I'll tell you, 2 years ago, God changed my heart. He changed my heart. And I saw things from a completely different capacity. I saw things in a different perspective, and now I when they ask me to come play in the praise band, it's a chore, it's a job. I love to sing. I still love to sing, but I love to preach God's word, and it is such a God has put a burden on my heart for our people. He's put a burden on my heart for. I still get to hang around young people. They let me do that a little bit with a court-ordered 50-foot distance. I'm just kidding. God has given me so many opportunities. And I'll share this quick story with you very quickly before we get started, because we are a church as a whole, Big C Church, the worldwide church is who we are. And so we celebrate in the things that happened. And I shared this on Facebook a little bit because I'm very honored to know this young man. But there's a young man who came into my life, in our lives about 3 years ago. His name is Isaiah. Isaiah was struggling. He was struggling a great deal. He was struggling in school. He was struggling with faith. He was struggling with if God even existed. And I had the opportunity to just be a part of his life. Anna Grace started running in the sixth grade cross country for St. John. I had two boys who, Jared loved to be an athlete, but Jared used to love to get out here for upward football and do the Heisman pose. That's what he loved about being an athlete. Jacob was never an athlete. Anna Grace became my athlete. In sixth grade, she started running cross country. Her seventh grade year came around, and the coach who was there, who was also a teacher, left and went somewhere else. She had a passion for it. She loved it. So did all the other girls and guys, and we had an opportunity to step into that role because I didn't want to see that go away. It was something that they were passionate about, and I felt God calling on my heart that this was another way to pour Christ into these kids. Now, just because we go to a Christian school, let me understand, and we've been through the Christian school thing before. just because it's a Christian school. It's a Christian school, not a school full of Christians. It is a huge ministry field. After COVID, it became an even larger ministry field in these private Christian schools, because you have people who are unchurched coming to a place where they feel like their kid's not going to get in trouble, there's a curriculum they like, their kids are being challenged, whatever the case may be. So, had the opportunity to start pouring into these kids, and I loved it, and I immersed myself. I know you look at me and say, Tony, I can't imagine with your physique that you would have trouble understanding what it was to be a cross-country runner. Oh, I know. It's okay. But I dove into everything that I could learn about cross-country, how to run. I took courses from some of the best cross-country, collegiate cross-country coaches in the country. And I learned everything I could because I wanted to make them better. Because if I was going to pour Christ into them, I wanted them to see that I was as committed to everything else that they were involved in as I was about how as much as I wanted them to be involved with Jesus. I was immersing myself into them so that they would see Christ in me and want to do the same and come to know Jesus. Never in a million years would I have thought I'd have been a cross-country coach. Never in a million years would I have thought I'd had the opportunity to pour into those young men and women the way that I have and to see so many lives turned around for Jesus Christ. Never in a million years would I would have thought that we would have competed for a state championship and then a year later won that same state championship. And never in a million years would I, this is where it's going to get me. Would I have sat in that conference room yesterday watching that young man who we had prayed for and poured into praise the Lord Jesus Christ for what he had brought him through as he put pen to paper and signed his name for his national letter of intent to run cross country for Erskine College? God is good. And he will put you in the place exact. I had no idea what God was doing when he called me away from the place that I called home for 14 years. And now I just look and I tell you one small story of what God is doing and why he called me from this wonderful place to the wonderful place that I now call home at Calvary Baptist Church. It is God. And we follow him and we trust him in everything that we do. We are the Big C Church. You sent a missionary 15 miles down the road to do what God had called him to do in that area of South Carolina. Amen. Three pastors met together one afternoon. And they said, you know what? I got a mouse problem. Every one of them talked about how they've got a mice problem. They can't get rid of the mice in their church. The first pastor said, you know, since the summer started, I've been having trouble. I've tried everything. I've tried noise. I've tried spray. I've tried crats. Nothing seemed to scare them away. And the second pastor said, yeah, my church too. Hundreds of them live in the basement of the church. I've set traps. I've called exterminators. Can't figure it out. Third pastor said, I had the same problem. So I baptized them all, made them church members. I ain't seen a rat since. Yes, that is a Pastor Jimmy Fuller joke right there. Listen, fellowship, we talk about fellowship. And I want to bring this kind of to a close tonight. As you've been talking about the unity of the church for the last four nights, and I want to kind of bring that around and kind of put on a practical stance on what it means and what it looks like. We talk about fellowship being one of those church words. It's a word that isn't commonly used by non-Christians. That's one of our words, right? It's also a word that's misunderstood and it's misused a lot of times by Christians. We have our fellowship hall, we have our fellowship dinners, we have our fellowship meetings, but what exactly is it? What does it mean? What does it mean to fellowship? What is it? How does it relate to God? How does it relate to Christians? How does it relate to non-Christians? Is a fellowship a potluck dinner? It can be. Is it a Sunday school class? Yes, can be. Is it joining the church? It could be. Is it becoming a Christian? Yes, it can be. The dictionary defines fellowship as a companionship or a friendly association. It's sort of like, it gives the idea of this mutual experience, this mutual sharing of experiences together, of these activities, of these interests together, and a group of people with the same interests, sort of like a brotherhood, right? So the Greek word for fellowship, and I know you all heard this word before, is koinonia. Koinonia comes from a root word meaning common or shared. And it means that we are in community. We have a common unity together in the Lord Jesus Christ. So fellowship means common participation in something, either by giving what you have to the other person or receiving what he or she has. Give and take is the essence of what fellowship really is. And give and take must be the way that fellowship is in the life and the body of Christ. So there's a few things that I want to look at tonight as we look into this idea of fellowship. And the first one I want you to see the foundation of fellowship tonight. The foundation of fellowship. Here's God's design for community. In the beginning, God created mankind in his own image. And then in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, it says, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper corresponding to him.'" You see, God designed us for community. He designed us for fellowship with one another. The foundational truth highlights the importance of relationships. It emphasizes that we are not meant to journey through this life in isolation. As Pastor Jimmy used to say for years and years, there's no such thing as a Lone Ranger Christian. We can't do it on our own. We are meant for fellowship. We are hardwired for community with one another. But I want you to look at something else. I want you to look at the fellowship of the Trinity. You see, because we get this idea of fellowship because of the very Godhead of God himself. Amen. The triune nature of God serves as the ultimate model for our fellowship. Because you see, in the Godhead, we witness the perfect communion of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Their unity in purpose, in love, And in essence, what it does is it exemplifies the divine fellowship that has eternally existed. This fellowship has eternally existed. And so to think that we can do something separate from that goes against Scripture. It goes against our Maker. Their unity and purpose and love and all of that has eternally existed. As followers of Christ, we are invited to participate in this sacred bond of unity. And I'm going to tell you, I have learned things about me in the last few years. And there's something that I learned. Everybody has always told me, "Oh, Tony, you're such an outgoing person. You're such an outgoing person." No, I'm just loud and obnoxious. That's what I am. I'll tell you the honest truth. I am an introvert. I am truly an introvert. It takes me a long time to get to know somebody. I'm not, God bless you. Because if you hadn't have reached out and made those phone calls, and if you hadn't have said, "Yep, let's go to lunch and let's do all of this," and if you hadn't have opened those doors, I don't know that we'd have this relationship. It's because of you. And I love an outgoing person, and I love to be around outgoing people because I get energy from outgoing people. But as hard as an introvert, I'd rather be alone, y'all. I'd rather be alone. I'd rather just sit at the house, do my own little thing. Maybe every once in a while, once every 3 months, I'll open the blinds, let some light in, something like that. I've learned that I am an introvert, and I struggled for a very long time of this label that I got of being very outward and all of that kind of stuff. And I had to compartmentalize that and realize, but listen to me. That's who I am in the flesh. If it were up to Tony, yep, I'd be squirreled away for months at a time, binge watching about every show that I could find, you know, playing video games, whatever it is. That's who I am. That's not who Christ called me to be. Christ called me to be in fellowship with others. And so, because of his leadership, because of the love that he has for me, because of the glorious and wonderful obligation that I have to my Savior, I withstand the awkward conversations, the awkward pauses, the moments where I stand there and I'm just like, I'm looking at another person and I'm just like, you're an introvert too, because there's been 38 seconds of silence and all we've done is just stare at each other. Welcome to the brotherhood. That's the foundation of fellowship. The second thing I want to share with you tonight is some biblical examples of fellowship. When we look at the book of Acts, it provides for us a very vivid picture of the early Christian community and the depth of their fellowship. When we look at Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, it says this. It says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They sold all their possessions and property and distributed all the proceeds to all as any had any need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple, and they broke bread from house to house. They ate their food with joyful and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This describes believers devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, breaking bread together, praying, sharing their possessions. It's interesting. All the people, I've become a pastor now, so I hear it more often. A pastor, all you ever do is talk about giving. I have this wonderful little device here in front of me and this wonderful little piece of software that allows me to categorize, write, and index all of my sermons. And I have been full-time preaching since March of last year. I've done one message on tithing. One. But that's all they ever hear. But they'll say, well, you know, why does it have to be 10%? Well, that's what the Lord called us to. But if you want to look at a New Testament form, they gave everything. They sold everything they have and they gave it as anybody had any need. Sacrificed for one another. They sacrificed for one another. And just to throw the cherry on top, it says that they met together each and every day to study the Word. Not just on Sundays. Not just Wednesday night. They devoted themselves completely to God and to the fellowship of the people around them. The Christian fellowship was marked by genuine love. It was marked by sacrificial service and a shared commitment to Christ. The Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, frequently addressed the importance of fellowship in his epistles. In fact, in Romans chapter 12, verses 10 through 13, he encourages believers to be devoted to one another in love, to share with the saints in all of their needs, to practice hospitality. And Paul emphasizes all of this interconnectedness of the body of Christ and the responsibility that each believer has towards the well-being of others. In fact, just to open that up, the verses, Romans chapter 12, verses 10 through 13, say this: love one another deeply as brothers and sisters. Take the lead in honoring one another. Do not lack diligence and zeal. Be fervent in the Spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in afflictions. Be persistent in prayer. Share with the saints in their needs. Pursue hospitality. How many of us can truly say that the people that we share life with, have been the recipients of our fervent prayer, of our rejoicing with them? How many of them have received the gift of our patience? For the people that we truly love, for the people that we want to do life with, I'd say that's pretty easy. But Paul doesn't put a qualifier on who we're to love. He doesn't say love the brothers and sisters. He says to love one another as brothers and sisters. So that boss that's on your tail all the time and yelling at you and not treating you fair, we pray for him. We be patient with them. Those people who do bad to us, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to love them. We're supposed to be patient with them. According to Scripture, we're supposed to be persistent in prayer. It's what we're called to. It's the biblical examples of fellowship that we have that are laid out before us. We're to love one another, even when it's hard, even when it doesn't seem fair, even when they're they hurt us to our core. I want you to see the essence of true Christian fellowship as well. True Christian fellowship finds its foundation in our common identity of Christ. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28 says, "There is no Jew or Greek, no slave or free, no male or female, since you are all one in Jesus Christ." I shared with Pastor Bradley. I've gone back and forth and I have wrestled with this message. And I want to say it this way. Unity and fellowship is not something that's found in one person. It's not something that's dictated by a person. If there's anything I've learned in my years of ministry, it's that we can have unity, and as long as we're on the same path, as long as we have the same desired outcome, as long as our motivations are biblical, are true, and are trusting in Jesus, we can disagree. We can disagree. We don't have to walk out of somewhere I might be hitting it a little too hard on the nose here. We don't have to walk out of a meeting and everybody say in agreement to the outside, this is what we're doing. But on the inside, we're wrestling. We're wrestling with what we truly believe is God's calling. We can disagree, and it's okay. Because unity isn't found in a person. The source of unity comes through the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and nowhere else. Man cannot create unity. Unity comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. We can have a lot of common fellowships. We can be Gamecock fans and Tiger fans. Or if you're in the minority like me, you can be a Tar Heel fan. I realize I pull for the right Carolina, but I live in the wrong one. Listen, we can have fellowship over those kinds of things. Unity comes from somewhere else. Unity comes from our relationship and our Savior. We are all one in Jesus Christ. And it transcends anything that's social, cultural, economic. It transcends every one of those things. It creates a bond that unites believers in a profound and supernatural way. Talk about mutual edification here. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. They say this. He says, "And let us consider one another in order to provoke love and good works, and not neglecting to gather together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging each other, all the more as you see the day approaching." Paul is exhorting believers to consider how to stir up one another in love and good works, not to neglect meeting together. Christian fellowship is not only about shared experiences, but it's about mutual encouragement. It's about edification. It's about building each other up, holding each other accountable, and loving on one another to see each and every one of us grow to be more and more and more like our Savior. That's the purpose. That's the purpose of being a Christian. It's not hell insurance. It's not any of those things. It's accepting the mercy that God has given you. It's putting Him on the throne of your life and letting Him take everything, and then chasing after His truth and His word, becoming a disciple and chasing after Him. It's about growing and becoming who God has called us to be. It's about experiencing the wonderful love and mercy of our Lord and Savior each and every day as we struggle to pick up our cross and follow Him, knowing that we're walking through the mud and the mire of this world, that we're walking through the residual effects of the bad decisions that we made. You know, there are decisions that I made in my 20s before I even knew Jesus Christ that I still carry with me, that I still deal with the effects of those decisions that I made. They'll be a part of who I am until the day I leave this earth and I'm clothed in something new as I stand before the Father. But nowhere in God's wonderful word does it ever say that becoming a Christian makes life easy. We're to build each other up, help each other grow towards that goal of being more Christ-like. But there's some challenges to fellowship. There's some challenges to fellowship. There's division and disunity. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10 says, "Now I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree in what you say, that there be made no divisions among you, and that you are united for the same understanding and the same conviction." Well, Tony, you just said that it's okay to disagree with somebody. Yes, it's okay to disagree with somebody as long as we're both standing firm on the word. We can see things differently. What Paul is writing to is a church body of believers who are hearing all kinds of different things and things being whispered in their ear, and these people who are telling them that, well, to be a Christian, you really got to do this, and since the Lord Jesus was Jewish, we got to go back and be Jewish, and then we can come back and be Christian again. But that's not biblical. While the Bible extols the beauty of fellowship, it also addresses the reality and the challenges that hinder all this. He's pleading with the Corinthian church to be united in mind, to be united in judgment, warning against these divisions that come in, these disagreements, these disputes, this discord that can threaten the unity of the church. And where does it come from? People say it comes from Satan. I struggle with that. struggle that it comes from Satan. Let me tell you why. I'm just going to be completely honest with you. I'm going to be raw and open. And I hope you'll understand my heart when I say this. Satan is not omnipresent, omniscient. He's not everywhere. He's not all-knowing. He's not all of those things. But let me go back and focus on the omnipresent for just a moment. Satan cannot be everywhere at all times like God is. And so, therefore, I really don't think that Satan is whispering in your ear. You must be some kind of super Christian for Satan to be whispering in your ear, right? Like you have the cure to cancer and war and everything right inside for Satan to be whispering in your ear. Now I'm not talking down to anybody. Just let's be honest. We like to use that phrase, well, Satan made me do it. I don't think any of us in this room qualify. You know what I think happens? I think it's us. I think it's our pride. I think it's our way of wanting to do things. Maybe we want a little more control in the church. Maybe we want people to see things our way. And so we'll start talking just a little bit. And we'll create a little more disunity and all of that. If I'm over my time, y'all let me know and just throw me out. So I hear things beeping all the time. So, but listen to me. Listen to me. Y'all hear my heart on that? I love all of you. I think you're wonderful. But I don't think we rate on Satan's radar. I really think it's pride. I really think it's pride that digs into us. Here, y'all want me to answer it real quick? I'll talk to him. Don't they know you're in church? Again. Yeah. Hey, so we have this idea of division and disunity in our churches, but there's something else too, and it ties in with what I just talked about. It's self-centeredness. Our sinful nature within us often inclines us towards self-centeredness. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says this. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should not look into their own interest, but rather into the interest of others. This verse of Scripture instructs us to do nothing from our own selfish ambition, our own ways, our own thoughts, or in conceit, but in humility. To count others as more important than us. I'm more concerned about the people in my pews that I get the blessed honor to preach to. I'm more concerned about them than I am my own self. Overcoming self-centered tendencies requires a conscious commitment to putting the needs of others before our own. When I was here some years ago with our youth, I started this idea, this thing that I would teach to them over and over and over again. And I don't know where I got the words. Maybe it was divine. I'm not going to say divine revelation to run me out of church. But maybe God just planted a seed in my head, something that I had seen somewhere. But I started calling it being others-oriented. I want to live my life being others-oriented. I'm more concerned about making other people comfortable and happy and all of that than I am my own ways. I'll be sacrificial. It's okay. I can do without. It's okay. God has blessed me so incredibly richly with everything that He's given me in my life that I don't have any reason to be selfish. I'm fine with what I have. So I'll give to somebody else. But there's blessings behind Christian fellowship as well. Number one, there's spiritual growth. Proverbs 27:17 tells us this. Says, I'll be all right. It's late. I'm not used to preaching this late. And y'all have got me messed up. Iron sharpens iron, and one person sharpens another. Christian fellowship provides fertile ground for this spiritual growth and maturity that we talked about. Through this mutual accountability, through prayer, through fellowship with one another, through lifting each other up, just being around one another. Believers can be challenged and inspired to grow in their relationship with God, to have that more Christ-like character. But here's the second benefit we get out of it. It's comfort in trials. The journey of faith, it's messy. It's very messy. In times of hardship, Christian fellowship becomes a source of comfort and support. 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 and 4 says, "Blessed be to God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father of all mercies, God in all of our comfort. He comforts us in our afflictions so that we may be able, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction." God comforts us in our affliction so we can turn around and comfort other people. We don't have a right to take anything that God has given us and hold it. We're not a vessel. We're not a storage pot. What we are is a pitcher. I used this illustration when I had touched on this topic before at Calvary. And I said, do any of y'all remember? Some of y'all may still have them. Do any of y'all remember the old Rubbermaid pitchers, the orange ones that your grandmama had, right? And it didn't matter. After a while, it didn't matter if you poured tea out of it or if you poured Kool-Aid out of it. Two things were happening. Number one, it all tasted the same. And number two, it all had the stain on the inside that you could never wash out and never get rid of, right? But that's who we are. That's who we're called to be. We're called to be pitchers. God pours in love to us. We are to pour out love to others. God pours His mercy and His forgiveness into us, and we're to pour it out to others. God pours in the comforting for the afflictions that we go through, and we're to turn around and pour that out to others. It's when we don't do that, when there is no service, that we become legalists. That we sit around and point the fingers and say, well, no, it should be done this way, this way, this way, this way, when there's no action behind it. God comforts us in all of our affliction. The third benefit that we get from fellowship is that we get to bear one another's burdens. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2 tells us, it says, "Carry one another's burdens. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ." Christian fellowship is meant to share the weight of life's challenges, to offer a helping hand in need. The love and the care that is expressed within the body of Christ creates a safety net. It prevents individuals from being overwhelmed by the burdens of life. We also have one of the other benefits that we have to this is in our service. I watched with great joy what happened in Nazareth, Israel, with the Good Shepherd Baptist Church in my time here at Harbor Lake. I watched five small churches come together to see God's mighty work done in Israel. And I have been talking to your pastor, and God put on my heart a mission that He has given us. And let me share this with you, and then we'll close tonight. Last year, when I became pastor, I used to call him the director of missions, but our head of our Screven Association of Churches called me, and he said, I have something I want you to pray about. I said, okay. He says, we take all of these backpacks to Kentucky. He says, Tony, you won't believe it. He says, there's extreme poverty in the area. All of those little towns dotted along that mountain range were put there by the coal industry. years and years and years ago. He said, and the coal industry's moved out. All of those people, the median income in that area is about $24,000 a year per family. Now, the difference is that they're only making that much money per family, but I've been there. Gas is still $3-something a gallon. Milk is still almost $4 a gallon. The cost of everything there is just the same as it is here. It's higher than it was yesterday, and it's going higher still. And these people are struggling. He said, notwithstanding that, he said, last year, this massive flood came through. And it literally wiped out many of these towns. And so they're still dealing with the effects of that on top of the poverty and everything else. He says, here's what I want you to do. We provide backpacks to the kids in some of these schools. And we give them all kinds of stuff. We give them toys and all that. But we give them soap and shampoo and all of that. It's kind of like Operation Christmas Child right here in our own backyard. He said, but I want you just to go with us. We're gonna go up there. We're going to do a mission project in the summer, and I want you to come, and I want you to check it out and see what you think. I said, okay. Y'all, I don't know that I've ever cried so much in my life. To watch these families struggle the way that they struggle. And the problem is that when you get into no jobs, no economy, no money, that's where the drugs start coming in. And so now you've got children in these schools who are now being afflicted not only with the poverty and the weight of all of that, but now mom and dad, or just mom or dad, dad may be gone, mom may be gone, broken families, all of this kind of stuff. Now they're putting drug addiction on top of it. And all these kids wanted was just to see somebody stable in their life for 5 minutes. I made 100 friends the week that I was there. 100 friends. Kids followed me around. We went and did VBS at a apartment complex. We just set up in the middle of the apartment complex and said, hey, we're going to be out here at 6 o'clock. Y'all come on. We had 5 little kids and 23 teenagers. And they started doing all the VBS music and all the dancing, and all the teenagers were looking at like, this is what we came out here for? So we backed up and punted and said, hey, let me try something. So I just started playing worship music for them. And they got into it. And they loved it. And they followed us around. It was the middle of the summer, so they were finding, hey, where are y'all going to be tomorrow? And they'd show up. They'd show up and help. They'd show up and hang out. They just wanted something different. They wanted something stable in their life. And so I came back to Calvary, and I shared with them what I shared with you. And I said, I really believe that God is calling us to this mission right here. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 says that we are to be God's witness in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the world. Jerusalem means your town. Judea means your surrounding area, your county, your state, whatever it is. I know a lot of churches that do really good on those two. And then they do really well on the uttermost parts of the earth. We did that for a long time here at Harbor Lake. We have missions like that at Calvary. We've got a gentleman named Samuel Thomas who does orphanages in India, and we support him. We support a pastor in Burkina Faso in Western Africa, a place that's being taken over by all sides by Muslims. In fact, we just helped them finish a church building, put in the windows and the roofs. They started the process and ran out of money. And they called and said, hey, we don't have any windows. We don't have a roof on it. Is there anything that you could do to help? And we were like, yeah, what's it going to cost? And they said, well, it's going to be about $6,000 or $7,000 to finish it all out. And I put that in front of our people at Calvary. And I said, This is Pastor Kareem. We're going to be affecting these children. They have a school there as well. They just want a building to get out of the sun. It's getting hot there and all of that kind of stuff. We took up $8,500 that day and sent it to them. And then he called a couple of days ago and he said, "Hey, you know, we've got so many kids here that are coming to be a part of the school and coming to be a part of the church that the little well, the hand pump well that we have here, it runs out of water and we don't have enough water to be able to give all of the kids water. And if we're getting into the summertime and it gets, you know, a normal day in the summertime, it's probably 125 degrees here." So, but they've got these solar powered pumps that we could get that would go deeper and pull out more water, and we'd be able to give water to all these kids. And we're like, "How much is it?" And they were like, $3,000. And I was kind of like, "Didn't we just give you all that money like not too long ago?" And you know, that was the business side of me. And I went to our people and I said, "What do you think?" And they said, "Yep, do it." So we were able to do that just last week. We do those three really well. We do our community in the surrounding area, and then we send money overseas. But it's Samaria where we miss out. The United States has become the largest mission field in the world. And this is an opportunity that God dropped in our lap to be able to do this. They said, "Tony, we're putting together all of these backpacks. We'd love, if some of your people would love to come in December, we're going to go to these three schools in a little town called Whitesburg, Kentucky. We're going to give away these backpacks to," and there were about 1,200 of them. And it was being done by the entire Screven Association. 56 churches got together to put together these 1,200 backpacks to be able to do this. And we went up there, and I started asking my people after I'd told them the stories and all of that, and I'd showed them the pictures of what was going on in Kentucky, and I said, "Who wants to go?" I had to turn people away. 3/4 of the team that went last December were from Calvary. Their hearts were turned. They wanted to be a part of this. And so we went. We made 100 more friends. They gave me the opportunity in every one of the schools to share Christ. Not just in a book, a pamphlet, something. I stood there and preached to 1,200 kids. 200 of them made decisions for Christ last December. This is a mission field that we have. 5 weeks ago, I got a call, and it was from our Screven Association, a lady named Susan Harris, who coordinates all of this. She said, "Tony, I want to pray. I want you to pray about something for me." I said, "Okay." She said, "You saw everything that I did last year." I said, "Yeah, it was a lot to put together those 1,200, and she was responsible for a majority of it. She had some people who came in and helped, but she did the majority of it." She said, "You know, this really isn't meant for the association. This is not what the association's supposed to be doing. Like, our associations are built to point churches in the direction of doing these mission opportunities, to finding this common unity and fellowship between the churches to be able to do these types of missions, not for the association to do it itself." I said, "I get what you're saying. What you're trying to say is you want us to take one of those schools." And she said, "Yeah, I want you to take one of the schools." I said, "Okay." I said, "Are we still talking about the three that we went to in Whitesburg?" And she said, "Yep." I said, "I can already tell you, if God leads us this way, I know which one he's calling me to." She said, "Really?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "Because those little kids touched my heart like nobody else did." It's a little school called Martha Jane Potter Elementary School. They're the Cardinals. They showed me pictures from the flood when I went there last summer. I said, "You see those smokestacks that are sticking up out of the water?" I said, "Yeah." "Those are the vents from the school. The rest of the school is completely underwater." I said, "Oh." I said, "Every one of these kids was affected. In fact, there were children who went to that school While the flood was happening, there were literally parents who were hanging on to trees, trying to hold on to their children, doing everything they can, and their grip just wasn't strong enough. Children from that school swept away, never to be seen again. I said, Susan, if we're going to do this, that's the school I want. That's the school I believe that God is calling us to. And so I prayed for a long time, and I asked a lot of people. I said, tell me I'm crazy. We're not a big church. At that time, we were running about 120 people. I said, tell me I'm crazy. Shoot holes in this. They're like, we can't do that because we think this is what God is calling us to do. And I said, okay. I said, but the problem is I don't think we can do it ourselves because this is 300 students in the school. It's 300 backpacks. If we were to take and just, Calvary were just to buy all the stuff and just make the backpacks, just, you know, a committee of us, four or five of us, we just bought it all, it cost us in the neighborhood of $25,000. We didn't have the money to do that. So we're going to have to ask our people to come and help. Okay. So I told our people, I said, so this month we need 300 toothbrushes and 300 containers, tubes of toothpaste. I'm okay. I promise it's late. I'm way past nap time. Do you know the next Sunday they brought it in? Our whole church, 300, just took care of it right away. And then I started praying, and I said, God, give me vision on this and what I'm supposed to do and how we are to be God's kingdom, the big C church in all of this. And so I called Pastor Bradley, who was nice enough to invite me out to lunch and to talk my ear off and make the introvert feel comfortable. And I said, hey, let me share this with you. And he said, yes. Before he even came and talked to any of y'all, he said, yes. Here's what I'm asking. In the spirit of common unity, the Big C Church, those who can't come together to do something that only God can do, I'm asking for your help. I had not planned on doing this tonight. I had a conversation with Pastor a little while ago. He said, I hadn't even told him. I was like, okay, can I tell him? He goes, yeah, go ahead. I said, okay, here we go. So this is the bonus part. I've been off notes for 10 minutes. This is just bonus stuff. Here's what I'm asking. Pray and see if God is calling Harbor Lake to help us in this mission. Not just to collect stuff. Not just to make backpacks. But I want to go up there and I have a vision. God has given me a vision to affect families. To go up there. To support our teachers. To go to those schools and just before school starts, a week or so before school starts, when they come back and they're like, I got all this stuff. Hey, you got 5, 6, 7, 8 people here who just want to help move stuff. We'll move desks. We'll move bookcases. We'll hang stuff on the wall. We'll wax floors. We'll throw out trash. We'll do whatever you need us to do. Oh, and by the way, we want to share with you, too, that how much Jesus loves you. We want to be that tangible expression of God's love for you. And then I want to go, I challenged, we have a small group of youth, former youth, who have now graduated and they're trying to find their place. And I challenged them this past, a couple of weeks ago, I said, hey, would y'all think about going up there and doing a vacation Bible school? We'll get up there, and we've got missionaries on the ground. We've got contacts on the ground. We'll get people together. We'll have them advertise it. We'll just have a bunch of y'all will be in charge of the VBS. Their faces lit up. Listen to me. we're of an older generation. I turned 51 a few weeks ago. I know I don't look it. Listen, we understand we're an older generation, and this younger generation that's coming up, there's a few of them in here. Listen, we do the generation wars, right? The Gen Xers are, you know, barking against the boomers, and the boomers are like, oh, get off my lawn, and all of that kind of stuff, right? But listen, can I tell you something that I've noticed about these latest generations? You can't sit down and tell them. They don't want to just take it from a book. They want to experience it. And when you give them the opportunity to get involved, they light up. They light up. I'm telling you, this next generation that's coming up, Gen Z, the alpha generation, who's just now probably in the 10, 12, 13, 14-year-old range, I'm telling you, they experience things. They see it enough. They want to experience it. They're the first generations who have grown up with digital technology in their hands from the time they were born until now. They see it all the time. They're not like us. We went out and made all the mistakes. Now we get to laugh at other people making the mistakes that we made when we were younger. It's the other way around with this generation. They've seen it. Now they want to experience it. They want to see if Christ is real on their own, and the opportunities that we give them will make a difference. Because you see, it's not about the seniors, and it's not about the middle age group, and it's not about the new families, and it's not about then the youth and then the children and all of that. We've got to stop thinking that way. We have common unity in Jesus Christ. We all have the same mission to grow, to disciple one another, to hold each other accountable, and then to go, as Matthew chapter 28 tells us, to go and share His word and make a difference in the world around us. That's what He's called us to do. That's what He's called us to do. Father God, we thank You for Your word. We thank You. And Lord, I pray Lord, that our hearts would be united, that we would understand that it's not about what we think is supposed to happen, but Lord, we're supposed to come and chase after Your will for us. And You put opportunities in our path, Lord, and it's up to us. Are we going to discern them? Is this what God is? Is it a godly thing? Then let's chase after it. Father, I pray that Your word tonight would move our hearts. That we would understand that it's not about just coming into church and sitting and gathering up information. But no matter what stage of life we're in, we have purpose. And we have a common unity with the people around us, a community of people who we are called to do this life and this ministry with. We are the hands and feet, not the hand and the foot. We do this together. Father, thank You for these wonderful folks here at Harbor Lake. Thank You for my church family. They'll always be my church family. Thank You for their love. Thank You for their love for You. Thank You for their love for their new pastor. Father, and I pray many, many rich blessings over them as they together as one, through Your word, reach this world for Jesus Christ. Lord, we praise You, love You, in Jesus' name, amen. By the way, as I went to pray, I read this. She didn't read that first part. My dad wanted Tony Stark, but instead he got us Tony Stevens. Every good thing I said about you, I take. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. God bless you, church family. Love you.
Iron Man. He's Iron Man. Thank you, Tony. What a great message, and what we have an opportunity. What we're going to be doing now is praying about how we can connect. And Tony, you know, like you said, this we've had these conversations, and we haven't put any wheels behind it, but in the coming days we're going to. When he shared with me this concept of partnering for Kentucky, it as soon as he said Kentucky, my mind lit up to a time when I went to Kentucky. And he shared with me, and he said Whitesburg, and I thought, Whitesburg, that sounds familiar. And I got to look and pulled up the map, and that was the town I went to. And we've talked about some of the elementary schools, and one of the elementary schools he went to, I went to do the same type mission work. And everything he's told y'all about this area is true. And so I don't know to what level. We're going to pray about it as a church and see how we can support. As for me and my house, we're gonna be a part. Because as you said, there's that, you know, those little ones that want to experience it. I've got three that I'd love to take, a wife that would love to go. So, you know, I can speak for me, and I feel, you know, when I said yes, knowing y'all would do it too. Y'all would be wanting to help. And so we're going to be praying in the coming days and figuring out how we can help. Another just God wink on this Kentucky thing, the church that we went and served, guess what the name of their pastor was? Tony. I said, Whitesburg First Baptist, Tony. I said, that's just a little wink. That's just a little confirmation. But just the people and seeing, it's just a whole different world up there. And so I want to challenge us to be praying about how we can help. And in the coming days, we'll have some meetings and come up with a good plan, a team. You know, that's the thing. It'll be on the hearts. If you take this and look at this, I think it'll be on your heart. So that's the challenge. All right. So here's how we're going to end things. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to stand, and I want some of y'all to come up here. We did this back at the fifth Sunday sing to close out, and it went really good. I want to do it again. We're going to sing I'll Fly Away. And that's how we end. I saw somebody go, ooh. And I'm waiting on the la-la behind it. We're going to sing I'll Fly Away. And what a way to end. We're not going to just sit in these four walls. We're going to fly right out the door and into this world. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to celebrate Teresa tomorrow. She's flying on down to Florida soon. Wherever we end up flying, one day we're going to take a big flight. And that's what we're looking forward to. So I want to invite some of y'all to come up here, whoever wants to, come on. And Travis is going to cue it up. And after this song's over, you're at liberty to go. I know Tegan's coming up here. Come on. Teresa, come up here. You better go with her. Come on. Here we go. Come on up here. Donna and Marty, come on. Start calling people out. David Luther, you're being paged. Come on, sing with us. Here comes Ken. See, Ken's coming. Who else? All right. Everybody, if you would stand and let's sing together. Come on up here, anybody that will. Come on up here.